Send us someone that really loves this church, loves us as individuals, and will always make himself available for us. And you know, this is just an opportunity for us to come together just to share our appreciation and just to tell you thank you for your unconditional love that you have for us. And we know it, we see it, and we feel it every day. And we thank you for that. We really do. Amen. Just a couple of quick announcements this morning. So first of all, and we will be having a dinner in the fellowship hall following the service this morning. We were planning on doing it outside, but because we've got some rain, so we're going to have to make some last minute changes. But so at the end of the service, we certainly want everyone to stay. We've got plenty of food, but we will be dismissing in smaller sections. So just please be patient so that we can dismiss, and so I'll be directing you guys at the end of the service on that, okay? We're just so thrilled to have the Ash family with us today. We're all in the family. We love you guys. We're so thrilled to have you with us today, and of course, our pastor's family, our mom and dad. And, we just welcome you to the Northside Church of God. We just want to make you guys feel like family because you truly are. This morning, I just wanted to open up and just share a couple of thoughts and a couple of scripture verses that I believe that the Lord has put on my heart. And actually, one of the verses I ended up going into the Old Testament, the Minor Prophets, in the book of Micah. And verse number, chapter 5, verse number 4, and I understand that this prophecy is really speaking about Jesus Christ. But whenever I was reading this, I just could not help but think about Pastor. So I wanted to share this morning with you. In the book of Micah, chapter 5, verse number 4, the Bible says this. It says, "He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord God, and they will live secure."
Amen.
Amen. That, I just, whenever I read that, I thought, yeah, that's our pastor. That's who we have. We have a pastor that God has sent us, but he's not just a pastor, but he's a shepherd that truly cares for the well-being, our spiritual well-being. And in him and what he's doing, church, we have security. Ultimately, it's through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, but it's through the anointing that God has placed upon him that we have that shepherd. And we just really appreciate him. Also, in the New Testament, 1 Timothy chapter 5, and verse number 17, and it says this. It says, "The elder who direct the affairs of the church, well, are worthy of double honor, especially those who work in preaching and teaching." Pastor, you're worthy of double honor. Much more probably than what we're going to do this morning. But I just wanted to share those two verses of scripture. And just basically share just telling you much. I love and appreciate you, my family. And I know we're just blessed to have you as our pastor and our shepherd. Thank you. If you will, stay with me this morning as we go to the Lord in prayer. At this time, we're also going to receive our morning tithes and offerings, and the way that we will do that is at the end of the prayer. If you have tithes and offerings that will stay here in the local church, if you will, just look. We'll start with the section to my left. If you'll come up and deposit your offerings, and then we'll go to the middle section and then to the right section. If you will, just join with me in prayer. Father, we thank you for this opportunity and be here today to be able to celebrate and honor our pastor, a shepherd that you have given to us, a shepherd to lead us and to lead this church and this community. And Father, we just thank you, God, we just pray that you would just continue to honor them and bless them and direct them and guide them. But Father, I also pray that we would stand with him, that we would uplift him in prayer each day. Lord, we know that a pastor faces challenges. We know that faces difficulties, and I pray that we would just bind together, God, in prayer, and that we would just continue to lift him up. And Father, today we just, as we continue to worship and in giving of our tithes and offerings, Father, we just pray that you would bless the gift of the giver in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Amen.
You are here. Children, and children, and children, and children, and come before you and behind you and beside you, all around you, and within you, He is with you, He is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, He is for you. Church, I just want you to stretch your hands forward towards our pastor. And as we pray this morning, I just pray that we would just unify. Stand behind our pastor. Lift him up in prayer. And be there for him as he has been there for us. Church, if you will, just join with me in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you again for our pastor. We thank you for the shepherd that you have called, the shepherd that you have sent to carry forward and be the pastor and the shepherd of the Lord's house. And Father, we're just so blessed because of his ministry and because of what you have done through him. And Lord, today as we honor him, we honor you. And Father, we pray with all of our heart, God, that you would just continue to bless.
bless and to anoint. But God, we also pray for a hedge of protection around him and his family. God, as we lift him up, we know that the enemy would love nothing more to do than to tear him down and to destroy his family. But God, we're going to rebuke that. And in the name of Jesus, we believe that you're going to just build a hedge of protection around him, that you're going to keep him and his family safe, and that God, that you're going to continue to anoint, and that you're going to pour out your spirit upon him, and that, Lord, that he will continue to direct this church, and God, that all things will be done for you and for your kingdom. And Father, again, we just pray for our church, we pray for our community. In Jesus' name we pray.
Good morning. Y'all can be seated. We have a little presentation this morning to give. Pastor Mooney, I hate to make you stand back up, but I need you to stand up. You know, we've all been affected and impacted by COVID. And basically, as of January, the church closed. And pastors all over the world had to think out of the box about how they were going to reach their churches. And I will tell you that I know firsthand, our pastor sought the Lord. While most churches sat back, most churches were behind the doors, our pastor had a list of mine. He had a vision. And you know, the Bible says a man without a vision will perish. That's not the case of our pastor. He's the shepherd of this church, and he had to not gather one and leave the 99. He had to find us all. Every week, every month, we would get texts. We would get phone calls. We would get notes in the mail. Mother's Day, we got gift certificates in the mail. In our dark hours, I know personally, in the midnight hour, this man was up at midnight helping me make funeral arrangements. He has been with each and every one of us through every step of the way, and Sister Wendy too. And we appreciate that, because your love for this church is far beyond measure, and we know that you were sent by the man above. But it doesn't stop in the church. The one thing that this man shows to all of us is the passion for a human being. He is on fire in our community. On top of being a pastor, he drives kids on a school bus. He's involved in the schools. He's involved in the hospital. He's involved in the community. It doesn't stop at the church. And that's what he teaches us to do. And if you stop and think, and you will be surprised, at every single thing in the midst of COVID, I don't think there's too many churches that can say that we fed the school, we fed the hospital, we sent Bibles to China, we went to Honduras and ministered there, we did stuff for the school system, and even lately, I mean, we did Halloween treats for the kids on the bus. We were managed to have a baptism. We did church membership twice. I don't think too many churches were able to accomplish that in the middle of COVID. And that's all because this man and woman love us, and they seek the Lord about us. So, Pastor, in your words, baseball games, you taught us to get out of the batter's box if we're going to do anything. And we have to get out of the infield, too. So we got out of the batter's box, we got out of the infield, and we even hit it out of the world in world missions. We've put a little video together, but before we show that, I want to present you and Sister Wendy with a little gift. We know cruise ships aren't running. We know baseball games aren't going. So for you, Pastor, we just had to give you a little green love to think about what you want to do. And Sister Wendy from the Ladies Ministry, which, yes, we got it up and running, and no, it's not going away. We know that family, pictures, and shopping mean a great deal to you. So we tried to combine that from the Ladies Ministry. We would like to give you the tree, family tree with all your favorite places to shop and eat in store. So we love you. Thank you. And on behalf of our creative arts team, you know, every time you try to do one of these events and put something together technology-wise, the devil always has to stand in the middle of it. And Sister Amy and Noah, and I know you even had to reach out to your son out of the way to help, but we think we've got it together. And Pastor, this message, if nothing else, sums up this year, and you taught us to think outside the box and do something.
Saw a world full of trouble now. How we ever get so far down? How's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. Thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you. Now listen. If not I stand, if not me and you, right now, well, it's time for us to do.
beyond the four walls of this church. And that's what it's about. It's about what goes on out there. It's about how we can go out beyond the four walls of this church and let the love of Christ shine through us. Amen. Amen. I'm just, again, I can't, you know, say anymore. Pictures is worth a thousand words. Amen. At this time, I want to honor to introduce our guest speaker this morning, for all of your family. We're just, you know, so happy to have you guys here with us to celebrate this pastor appreciation. And we just want you guys to know that we love you guys very much. And blessed to have you with us again this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, what a morning we've had so far. I just want to take a moment to just applaud this congregation for how you celebrate your pastor. The tribute that you've provided to him already is astounding. And it speaks to the work that Pastor David is doing. What he set out to do when he came here 6 years ago, because it says it's been six, going by quickly. And what he's doing, the mission is going forward. Regardless of what the world does or what's happening, he has stayed focused on the mission of Christ. And so, well done. Well done. And of course, to a very worthy man of God, I can say he deserved about 90% of those compliments. No, 100%, Pastor David, you are. So, want to, again, thank you. I also want to thank you for honoring me today. I'm humbled this morning to be able to stand here and have a beautiful congregation like yourselves to be staring at me this morning and expecting something good to happen. So I am humbled and I am thankful for this opportunity. Will you go with me in prayer? Father, God, first, I ask you, God, that you will remove my limitations. God, all my inabilities, my weaknesses, my flesh, God, that you will put those aside. God, that I can be an empty vessel. God, that you can use a mouthpiece. God, this morning, that your word can go forth out of me. God, and I ask you, God, that you fill this sanctuary, God, with an expectancy, with an urgency. God, give us ears to hear. God, let your words find good soil. God, let us come out of here changed, different, ready for action. God, ready to move, equipped, and ready to change the world and see souls saved. God, and I ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. What has already been spoken is what a different year we have entered into in 2020, where we have face masks. And I have to tell you, I work in a school. I'm an assistant principal. And the other day we had a little get together where there was food. And I had to hide my expression because there are folks in that room I have never seen their face. And when they took their face off, it completely was different than what I had imagined they looked like. And so I was like, oh, who's that? So that's the kind of year we're having this year. And we have, who knew CDC or heard about CDC before this year? I have no idea what CDC was. And CDC guidelines, yet they seem to be ruling the world right now and telling us what to do and what we can say and what we can wear, where we can go, how we can do it. So I'm going to follow my background this morning. And I'm going to kind of talk to you and walk you through Luke 5. And I want to speak to you a little bit about if there was a test, would we test positive for Jesus? I'm going to take a little show of, like a little survey vote here today. How many of you had the COVID test? Anybody in here? Pleasant experience, wasn't it? Not too many people volunteer, but we have to do it sometimes. I've had that COVID test. And it's I had an interesting when this all first came out because I was working in the DJJ program. And they walked me behind the building. I couldn't enter the front of the building because we had a breakout and they thought I might have it. So that's the reason why I'm getting tested. So I had to be escorted behind the building up this ramp into this back room, like where the storage boxes were. And I sat in this chair, and I'm like, what is this going to be, like a black market surgery that's going to happen? I mean, what did I get myself into? And I sat down in this regular chair, and there's boxes around, and it seems like everything's dusty, and this guy comes out completely like he's going to be messing with, like, a bee's nest or something. You know, I can't see his face. He's got a shield on. And then he starts talking to me and says, this is going to be a little uncomfortable for a minute, and it's okay if you cry. So he said, just lean back, and he pulls out this Q-tip, and he begins to proceed to stuff this Q-tip up my nostril. And it felt like, I don't understand why 10 seconds wouldn't be good enough, but he was picking my brain for what felt like an eternity. My eyes started watering, I wanted to sneeze. I started tasting the medicine, and finally it was over. And I just couldn't wait to the results. And the results came a couple days later, and I was negative, and I was happy. There isn't such a test to see if Jesus is in your life. It would be nice for some of us if we could separate those who are living for Christ when we're walking through this world and those who aren't. But there isn't a test, and hopefully there's no pastor trying to stick a cross up somebody's nose and trying to test if you have Jesus in your life or not. But I'm going to walk us through Luke chapter 5, if you'll turn there. And there's four stories I want to address that possibly could be, and I'm going to try to use this kind of like a test. Hopefully you'll study throughout the rest of this sermon so there'll be a test at the end and see how well you do. Webster's definition of a test, a procedure intended to establish the quality, performance, or reliability of something before widespread use. A procedure or reaction used to identify or characterize a substance or a constituent. Luke chapter 5, verses 4 through 5 reads, "Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night, and have not taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net." Test question number one. Who is driving your life? We want to decide if you're going to test positive for Jesus. Who is driving your life? Have you given up? Have you surrendered? Here we find the fishermen who have been toiled all night. They've been working. They are experienced. They know what they're doing. Many of you have heard the story about the fishermen and how they gave up. They quit. They're cleaning their nets. Jesus comes along and he speaks to them and he teaches for a little while. And then he says something crazy. He says, you know what, guys? Go out a little bit deeper and drop your nets. And we find them saying, listen, Jesus, we've done this. We've been there, we've done that, and I'm telling you, maybe they had some scientific stuff that's not recorded. I can see some of our fishermen today saying, look, the currents aren't just right. There's a reason why there's no fish, Jesus. We know what we're doing. Look, we've cleaned our nets. We're done for the night. We appreciate you. Thank you for the teaching, but we're done. But what we find Simon saying is, look, this is crazy, this is ridiculous, but at thy word, we'll do it. At thy word, we'll do it. I recall a time just here recently, my son was home from college, and he was trying to do a good deed, and so he decided that he was going to go out, and he was going to mow the yard. 10 minutes later, he comes back in the house, and he says, Dad, I can't get the lawnmower started. I said, oh, let me go see what I can do. And he said, I'm doing everything right. I don't know what's going on. There's something wrong with the lawnmower. And so, well, I said, let's go out there together. And he gets on the lawnmower, and he's, yeah. Finally just said, stop. Before you break something, quit. You don't know what you're doing. Just stop and listen, will you? Just quit. And I proceeded, and he said, Dad, if I'm telling you, I'm not going to get it started. And so I said, get up. You know how dads do. Get up, boy, for a second. Let me show you. And I get on the lawnmower, and I do the, and I have to open up the clutch, put the gas all the way up, and fire's right. I said, I don't know how he did that. Sometimes in life, we have to feel like we're those fishermen and say, and Jesus is literally saying, stop. You don't know what you're doing. Quit trying it on your own. Lean not unto your own understanding. Will you just trust me? Just give me a shot. Okay? Before you break something really bad, just stop what you're doing. Halt. And listen, here's what I want you to do. I want you to cast out a little bit deeper. I know you don't want to. I know you don't feel like it. But do it. And we know what happened. At thy word, a multitude of fishes were captured. So much so that the nets couldn't even hold them. They called the other members of their crew, come help us. Such a blessing, an outpouring. If you're testing positive for Jesus, guess what you're going to find? An individual who is giving up, surrendering to Jesus and saying, God, what do you want me to do? God, at thy word, I'll go. God, you tell me, you lead me, you move me. Let me hear your voice, and I will move. I will do what you ask me to do. You'll find me in the hospitals. You'll find me in the prisons. You'll find me preaching on the street if I have to. You'll find me in service Sunday morning. You'll find me on my knees. You lead and guide me. Because what I am doing in my own flesh will not work. I need you. Are we tested positive for Jesus? It might mean that you have to help again. It might mean that you apply again. It might mean that you have to move out and go out and reach out again, one more time. It might mean that you reach a helping hand out again, although it didn't work the first time. When Jesus calls you out, you have to give up on your own understanding. Trust the Lord. Question number two on this text. Are you going to test positive for Jesus? What is your testimony? When was the last time you shared your testimony? Luke chapter 5, verse 12. It reads this, and it says, and it came to pass, when he was in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, who seeing Jesus fell on his face and besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Now you've heard many, many ministers talk about what it meant to be a leper. The fact that they were not involved in the community, they weren't allowed inside the walled cities, the disgusting aspects of the disease, how it would decay the skin down to the bone and create these nasty sores, how they would have to wear special garments that would declare that they're in mourning, waiting for themselves to die. How they would, if they got close to somebody, if they would have to call out, unclean, you've heard these things. And yet we find this leper breaking all of these rules, approaches Jesus, falls on his face, and says, "Will you heal me?" Now I'm going to recall a time, and I hope I don't embarrass my wife, but there was a time where she was not in my life. And I was just a typical crazy boy in college, right? Doing crazy boy things, seeking other girls' attention, right? I wanted to talk to girls. I wanted to have fun. I wanted to be athletic. I wanted to be cool. I wanted me to be exalted and exciting and funny. I wanted to get attention. Okay? It was about serving me. I didn't care what I looked like half the time. Sometimes I didn't care what I ate. If it didn't please me, I didn't do it. Anybody ever been there? And then I met Pam. All of a sudden, my thoughts got rearranged. All of a sudden, now I was thinking more about what I looked like. Matter of fact, there were times I was thinking when I would get dressed, I wonder if a man would like this. You know, not about what I wanted anymore. It was, I wonder if Pam would think this was cool. I mean, or does Pam want? Does she like facial hair or not? Should I shave or shouldn't I shave? Will she let my hair do? You know? It was a paradigm shift. Has anybody ever had a paradigm shift in your life? Where you thought one thing, like a lady in the airport who sees crazy kids running all around. And they want to report the kids because they're going crazy. No one's, they're unbehaved, they're just going crazy. Right? And then someone tells them that these kids' fathers just passed away. And they're not sure when these kids are going to be happy again and full of life. And she doesn't know how to tell these kids that their father is gone. And next thing you know, you find yourself playing with the kids and you know, carrying on. You had a paradigm shift. All of a sudden, it wasn't what you thought. Your whole frame of mind and thinking just shifted. When Pam came into my life, everything about me shifted. All of a sudden, I started thinking about her and what she wanted. And I thought, oh, I need to get a job. And I need to, you know, have some substance in my life. I need to be able to take care of her. And then when we had kids, our lives shifted. We started thinking about kids and how to raise children and how to have a family. If you're going to test positive for Jesus, guess what? There's a paradigm shift that happens in your life. It changes, it rearranges your thought process. You don't think about yourself anymore. All of a sudden you start thinking about other things, and it's strange. You start thinking, well, how can I help them? You're like, why do I care about them? I don't know them. It's a paradigm shift. It just changes everything. And if we go to this leper, he gets healed. And Jesus tells him to go to the priest. Show yourself, right? Because he had to have confirmation that he was clean. And when he's declared clean, Jesus was careful to say, you know, kind of keep it to yourself. Don't tell a bunch of people. What do you think happened? He told a bunch of people. He got declared clean. Now he got his citizenship back. He got accountability. He was a participant now. He was able to do a lot of different things. His whole life shifted. A paradigm shift. He was prepared to die, just waiting the days. And now all of a sudden he's alive. And not just alive, but he can participate. Not only can he participate, but he can get others to participate. And it says in scriptures that a multitude of folks looked for Jesus, right? Because of his testimony. What is your testimony this morning? What impact could your life and what God has done for you and that paradigm shift that took place Because if you have Jesus in your life, it may not be as dramatic as turning from a leper to a citizen. But Jesus did something for you. Completely turned you around. We need to share that testimony by the words of our testimony. We are what? More than conquerors. What's greater than that? What happened to our testimony services? Remember those, Pastor David? An entire service, we would just share testimonies. Maybe what kind of killed them a little bit is we talk about the leper and being the leper more than we did the citizen. Talked about how our life was ruined, and then we just say, oh, Jesus saved me. What's interesting here is sometimes a few try to hold on to the old, still try to hold on to a few things that we love and enjoy. Could you imagine a leper still trying to put the garments on as a leper? How weird that would be. You, who the Lord has set free, is free indeed. Amen? When you receive Jesus in your life, it's not just a one-time thing, but it's over and over and over and over again. You don't have to wear the garments anymore. You don't have to suffer the aspects of sin that was once in your life. You can be completely free. Now, I understand that sometimes there's a process and God works through us. It doesn't always happen all at once, but it needs to be a change process, because when God comes in our life, we are free. Let's look at Galatians chapter 1, verse 10. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be a servant of Christ. Your testimony. What has God done for you? Question number 3. How are you doing so far? You see? Okay. Amen. Question number 3. Do you love others? You want to test positive for Jesus? Then there should be love for others. John 13:35 says, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, for ye have love one to another. And we find in Luke chapter 5, verse 18, it says, and behold, men brought in a bed a man which was taken with palsy. And he sought means to bring him in and lay him before Jesus. You see, unbelievers don't have the ability in and of themselves to come to the Lord due to their sinful nature. We must love them so much that we are willing to go get them and bring them to the Lord. I recall a time where My two sons, Audie and Elijah, we were going to a Bears game here in Miami. And I'm not talking about superficial love when I say we need to love the lost and be willing to go get them. So I want to show you kind of what superficial love is. And so we showed up to that football game, and we had Bear jerseys on and Bear hats, and you know, our favorite team's the Chicago Bears. I hate to admit it now this year, but hopefully we'll do better. But we parked in the parking lot, right? And we were about 45 minutes early. And as we were walking to the stadium, we came through several tailgating areas, right? And when we would come across those that were tailgating for the Chicago Bears, because we were wearing Chicago Bears stuff, we felt like heroes. They were like, yeah, woo, 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 come over here. They were offering us food and stuff. Hey, come hang out with us. And we didn't know these folks. But because we had a jersey on, they loved us. They wanted to hang out with us, right? Then we would come across the Miami Dolphins tailgating area. And the love was short notice, because when we came through that area, it was, boom, get out of here. You're losing. You're a loser. You better hurry. We're walking a little bit faster, you know, through that, hoping to hurry up and get back to the Bears. You're like, yeah. And I can imagine someone's video recording that as we're walking to the stadium. Was, yeah, boo, as we're going through the stadium. That's superficial love. That's just a what can you do, or we, I relate to you. But what I want to talk about is what it took for those four men, the love that they had for the crippled man to get him to Jesus. Not to go too far in detail, but they had to have a plan. They had to think Jesus is coming to town. You know who needs to know Jesus? You know who needs Jesus right now in their life? Our friend. Hey, let's get together and make sure that he gets to Jesus. Imagine, Pastor David, if members of the church did that every Sunday morning. You know Pastor David's going to bring Jesus this morning. You know who needs to see Jesus this morning? My neighbor needs Jesus this morning. You know what? Four of us get together and let's go get him and make sure he gets to Jesus today. Imagine that. Now, of course, something happened in between. I don't know. They don't say in the scripture, but they must have been late. My family knows a little bit about being late sometimes. But the place was packed. And they couldn't get in. Had they been early, they could have gotten in, but somehow they were late or something. It was packed. They couldn't get in. Well, how many of you, I'm guilty of this, somebody's in need, and I say, well, I offered. They didn't accept. I tried. What else did you expect from me? I reached my hand out. They didn't take it. Oh, well. Wipe the sand off my sandals, move on right to the next situation. What did they do? They said, oh, let's find another way in. Let's go on the rooftop, tear up the roof, and drop our friend down where Jesus is. Imagine if we had that urgency. That much love. That's the love that Jesus is talking about here. If you're going to test positive for Jesus, you have to love others. That's what he does when he comes to us. We all of a sudden begin to see everyone, not just the ones that look like you, not just the ones that agree with you, not just the ones that laugh at your jokes, that you like hanging out with, but every person, you start seeing them as a child of God. And how do you treat your children? Right? How many of you who have children would say, I want my children to be better off than me? We can start understanding that scripture that says, brothers, esteem your brothers better than yourselves. Right? Then we start seeing everybody on this planet that, hey, I want them to be better than me. Imagine if we had that attitude with everybody we have ever met. They say, you know what? I have a love for you that I wish you the best, even if it means being better. I want you to be better. How would we treat others? What would come out of our mouth? What would our testimonies be? What would we say on our phone, or on Facebook, on Instagram, or Snapchat? What messages would we put out there? If we had that attitude toward others, that we loved them so much that we wanted them to be better than even ourselves. There's a story about a king who had these vicious dogs. And when somebody in his court would do something wrong or something he didn't like, he just sent them to the vicious dogs and watched them get torn to pieces. Well, he had this one royal guard, and he made a mistake. And he said, okay, I'm going to send you to the dogs. And he said, wait, hold up. I have served you for 10 years. I've made one mistake. Can you at least give me 10 days to just get my affairs in order, to say goodbye to my family? Just give me 10 days. The king said, okay, I'll give you 10 days. He spent those 10 days and found the keeper of the dogs. And he said, you know what? You need a break. Show me how to tend to these dogs. Okay, what do you do? What happens? And so he said, you teach me, and then you relax, and I'll take care of the dogs. And so he washed the dogs, and he fed the dogs, and he showed the dog love, and he took care of the dogs. 10 days passes, right? And the king says, you're going to be sent to these vicious dogs. And to their amazement, guess what happened? He came in, and the dog rubbed up against them, and they were licking his hand and his feet, and they were loving on him. They're like, what happened? What took place? He said, well, even though you forgot about all the things I did in 10 years for you, these dogs haven't forgotten that I've cared for them and loved on them for 10 days. They don't want to hurt. Now, I know that there's a little bit of an agenda here with why he took care of those dogs. But there's a difference when you love on people. Even the most vicious, most terrible sinner that you can think of, you can break God and break down the hardest of hearts with love. If churches go empty, can I say that, Pastor? Churches go empty, you might have a love problem. And I know something about Pastor David. Is that's one thing, if anything, he has the ability to just love on people. He just loves on everybody. Matter of fact, this has got to be really tough because it's hard in COVID time. I mean, he just wants to wrap his arms around you and love on you, tell you how much he cares about you and loves on you, and he loves people. There's not a love problem. But if you're testing positive for Jesus, you're going to love me. You're going to love me. Question 4 of 25. Just kidding. Question 4 out of 4. Is that better? Are you transforming? And do you take Jesus everywhere? You're going to test positive for Jesus. You're going to be constantly changing and transforming. You're not going to be stagnant. And you're going to take Jesus everywhere you go. There's a story about Sir Francis Drake, who is an explorer. And he explains in one of his journals that he was trying to recruit for an exploration trip. And he started off, he had a room full of men, and he began to explain that if you join my trip, you're going to see wonderful things, you're going to have treasures, there's going to be beautiful women, plenty of food. This is going to be a great trip for you. And what he found out is nobody joined. Nobody enlisted. Talk about all the wonderful things you're going to get, and they just said, bah. So the second day, he changed his approach, he changed his message, and he said, listen, men, my wife does this sometimes to me. I'll tell you about a parking spot. She said, if you're a man, you get that parking spot that's close to the building. For me, if you're a man, don't let that other person get that parking spot. But if you're a man, you get that parking spot for me. So I got the parking spot. But he said he changed his message, and he said, look, this trip is going to be the hardest thing that you're ever going to experience in life. The winds are going to be horrible. You'll be lucky if you don't get blown off the ship. There's going to be short supplies. Many of you might starve. There's going to be a lack of water. But the best of you will pack treasures. The best, the ones that survive, you'll see wonderful things. And to his amazement, everybody enlisted. What was the difference? The difference was there was a chance to see and prove that I was changing, I was going to improve, I was going to be the best. You gave me an opportunity not just to get stuff, but if I came back, I've earned it. I've improved. I'm a man. I'm strong. I'm the best of the best. What an opportunity. As we find in Luke chapter 5, verses 27 through 32, it says, "And after these things, he went forth and saw a publican named Levi," or Matthew, "sitting at the receipt of custom, and he said unto him, Follow me. And he left all, rose up, and followed him." Now, you know what a tax collector is, right? Probably the scum of the scum. I can just, by looking at the folks in this room, I can tell that you are excited about April 15th, that you enjoy the time that you have to give to the government for all the wonderful things they provide you, right? That you just love paying taxes. You're like, this is the best thing ever. Please let me pay taxes. No, and the biblical times, during Levi's times, he was able to add a little bit more to it. The more he got from you, he got to keep. And so he was not very popular. And so he was probably the worst of the worst. Yet he is chosen to become a disciple, and he eventually becomes one of the four great evangelists as an author of one of the four Gospels of Jesus. A constant change. I want to tell you a quick kind of a little story that's a little bit funny. But Glamour magazine said this about women looking in the mirror. Ladies, listen up. The average woman looks in the mirror 16 times. Right? Looking for improvement. Their focus when they look, according to Glamour magazine, is that they're looking at their flaws and wondering if they've improved or how they can improve. Ooh, I don't like that. I need to do something about that. Or I'm going to cover that up. Or I need to do something. They look for improvement. Now, men, what do you think the guys surveyed to be? The ladies were 16 times. The men, 23 times. It gets worse. Men, on average, they're not looking in the mirror to figure out what to improve. They surveyed to say that they look in the mirror 23 times a day for admiration. Look how good I am. And they, evidently, Glamour magazine, the number one part of the body that men just adored about themselves was their arms. You got it, buddy. Look at me. Looking in the mirror, looking for improvement. Ladies. See, God built us to have a desire. To want to shape up, to want to improve, to want to grow, to want to learn. Not to stay comfortable, not to just receive rewards, but to be challenged, to seek improvement, to be the best, to prove ourselves for Him. 2 Timothy 2:15 reads, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God." There's a survey that said 85% of individuals who live in a neighborhood don't know or can't confirm that their direct neighbor is a Christian. It went on to say, and another question is, why would you not be able to confirm that? Because, and they would 85% went on to also share and say that they don't see a difference between lifestyles from those that might not be a Christian or a Christian. Everything all seems to be the same. The story of Levi continues, if you were to read it. It says this, that once he followed Jesus and made that decision, guess what Levi did? He said, Jesus, I'm going to throw a feast for you. I'm going to celebrate you in my life. I'm not going to keep you a secret, but I'm going to take you everywhere I go. You're coming home with me. And I'm going to invite all of my tax collector friends to come and meet you. I'm going to celebrate, and everyone's going to know the change in my life and that I'm transformed. Imagine that. If you're testing positive for Jesus, he's not just the most amazing thing in your life on Sunday morning. He's not the most amazing thing in your life just when you talk to Christians. He's worthy of celebration in the midst of sinners. At work, at school, in Walmart. When you're really not sure if that's the right price you should be paying for something, he's still the most amazing thing in your life. Are we testing positive for Jesus? Now I'm going to tell you that there was a time here shortly, recent, before January, I would have told you that easily I would have passed these four questions. I've surrendered. I have a testimony. I share my testimony. Sure. Absolutely. I love others. And I know that I'm changing. I know I want to change. I know I want to improve. But that was tested. I don't know if you've ever seen, and sometimes I'm embarrassed to tell you this, but my wife is right there with me, and we're committed to this, and we're the same. But we think it's the most hilarious thing when we're watching a show or something, and out of the blue, like somebody gets hit by a bus. You ever seen something like that? And please don't judge me, but we rewind it, and that person's talking, and then boom! They just get taken out by a bus. We think it's funny. I don't know why. I don't think about them dying and all that stuff. I just think, wow, what a change. That was cool. That was cool. They were living and now they're gone. They're gone. Off the screen. Literally, that's what happened to us when tragedy comes in your life. It's like you're just singing a song in a car, and then boom, you get hit by a semi. Everything then changes. Who you thought you were and how great of a Christian you were, all of a sudden is tested. When your daughter is diagnosed with Hodgkin's lymphoma, it rearranges everything in your life. And in your whole family's life. All of a sudden, what you thought you gave up a long time ago, control of your life, you're trying to control life. And this is reminding you that you don't have control. You can't dictate this, but will you give it to Jesus? All of a sudden, you thought you had a testimony. You thought you had it all figured out. And then now, where's your testimony? What are you sharing? You still talking about being a leper? You still living a leper's life? Or are you going to declare the healing of Jesus? Are you going to declare what you see is not real, but God is in control of your life? He said by His stripes you are healed, and you declare that I believe that. It didn't happen instantly. But my family is still saying that promise is healed. We thought we loved people. But can I tell you that the love that was given to us during that time put us to shame. The donations that people gave us, the cards, the pictures, the abundance. I didn't know there was that much love. I didn't know anybody would care. I didn't know how this would happen. And I thought I was loving people. Now, don't lie. I haven't loved like that. I need to love more. How can I do that? What do I do? I need to love. All this love is coming to us, and I don't know what to do with it. I'm judging myself. And I'm getting scared, and I'm thinking, okay, how does this all happen? How do I love back? I thought I loved. And I thought I was on the right track. I thought I was taking steps. I was getting closer to glory. You know what I mean? Each day I was getting more Jesus. Loving life. God's blessing me financially, you know, employment. I'm yay. Yay. That's not the change. That's not the transforming. God taught me how to change where my flesh and my will has to go. And it's not about exalting Audie or you or anybody. But when you test positive for Jesus, it's going to become more about Jesus in your life than anything else. You'll stand with me. I don't know how well you did, but I failed in January. I'm doing much better now. As you look at the test, if you're testing positive for Jesus, some of you are passing, some of you might pass with a C. I don't know. My kid one time told me C's 50 degrees, Dad. I can tell you this. Without Jesus, it's impossible. It's impossible. You can fake it. You can get through a lot of stuff in life on your own. There's going to come a time where life is going to challenge you in a way that you can't handle. And without Jesus, you won't survive. You won't survive. That's the difference Jesus makes. You bow your heads and say a prayer. I don't know where each of you stands today. I don't know if you're an individual that has never really knew Jesus or doesn't care to know Jesus. I don't know if you're a person who's had everything going well for you in life and you think that you are full of Jesus. Maybe you're checked this morning and say, God, I do need more of you. I want to test positive for you. I do. I don't know where you are. You have to answer those questions for you and God. Father, I ask you right now that you arrest us. You hold us still for just a minute. God, all the things and all the festivities and all the stuff of life, if you'll just help us, God, put that in its place. Let us just focus on you for this one minute. God, we ask right now that you come into our life. We confess, God, we mess it up all the time. We are sinners. But God, it's your grace that can save us. It's your love that can save us. God, we ask for that love. We ask for that change. We ask for you, God, to come in to our life. God, make that difference. And God, help us every day of our life to continually to work with you. That we will give up. We will surrender to you. God, and at thy word, we'll cast into the deep. At thy word, we'll speak to the sinner. At thy word, we will go out. We'll reach out again. We'll throw that event on again. We'll call that person again. We will believe again. We will ask. We will request healing again. And again. And again. God, enable us, give us the courage, the ability, the opportunity, the stage, to share our testimony. God, we are committed to always changing and getting better. God, move in our lives today. Let these words, God, your words, capture us. That we will take action, not just rest, but we'll be urgent to save souls. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, church. Brother John, is it your turn now? Yes.
Church, what a powerful message. And I think we should all think about and really examine ourselves when we test positive in Jesus. Amen. Take a close look and think about it. Think about it. I think it's important for us to sometimes take a close look and really think about what our lives but then allow Jesus to work in us. Because we're truly the clay in the Father's hand. And great message, Brother Audie. And thank you for challenging us this morning. I ask you to come up and kind of close us out. And then at the end of that, we will dismiss. Again, we're going to do this in small sections. We're going to look on the stage and enjoy a time of fellowship. We had a meal in the fellowship hall this morning, but again, we do want our pastor and his family to get close to be dismissed in small groups after the pastor come out and close us out. So.
Amen. Thank you, Brother John. Thank you, Brother Audie. What a challenging word for us. Do we test positive for Jesus this morning? Amen. Since I got the mic, I want to say thank you to everyone for being here this morning, especially my family, my mom, my dad, my mom-in-law, of course, the Ash family here. Promise, we've been praying for you, girl, and we're still praying And we're believing with you guys for complete healing forever. Forever. Amen. Isn't it good to see promise in the house this morning? Amen. She just started high school. Believe it or not, about a week ago, she started actually the brick and mortar, however you want to call it. So we're praying for y'all. Thank you. Thank you, Audie, for what a word. What a challenging word this morning. Of course, it's so great to have my wife here. Isn't she beautiful? Amen. But thank you, everyone. And thank you, everyone, that helped in any way, organized, and whatever you've done. Thank you from Wendy and I. We love you. We love you, and we appreciate each and every one of you. Amen. I believe that our best days are ahead. COVID or no COVID, our best days are ahead. Amen. God is in control of all things. Amen. I guess let's stand and we'll pray to close out, right? And let's go ahead and pray over the food while we're at it, right? And then Brother John will give instructions on what we need to do going forward. Let me mention one thing before we pray. Don't forget that we have missionary David Addis coming next Sunday. He is our missionary to the Navajo Reservation out there in the New Mexico area, coming with the project. There's a great need because of COVID. They're on lockdown out there, and there's a great need, and he's going to share that with us next Sunday. So please, this week, pray about what the Lord would have you to do to be a blessing to this ministry, and we appreciate that. So keep that prayer. So John, would you like to pray closing? Want me to? Okay. Father, we just love you and we praise you. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful day you have given us, Lord, this day. Lord, that we have come together in your house to worship you, Lord. Lord, thank you for the challenging message that you gave Brother Audie this morning, Lord. Lord, I pray, God, that we would just not hear the word this morning, but we would be doers of the word. Lord, that we would be active. It would be active in our life, Lord, and that, Lord, you would help us each day of our life, Lord, as we go outside these four walls, Lord, and show the love of Christ to each and every person we meet. Father, I thank you for everyone gathered here today. Lord, I pray you bless them. Lord, you would bless their goings in and their coming out. You would bless them in the morning and the afternoon and the evening, Father, that you would pour out your blessing. Lord, that you would protect each one, Lord. Protect them from all harm, danger, illness, and disease, Father. Lord, and we just thank you for all that you have done and all that you're going to do. Lord, and we just pray, Lord, for our fellowship. Lord, we pray for the food. Lord, we pray that be strength and nourishment to our body, Father. Lord, bless the hands, Lord, that are serving. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for all that you have done and all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said, amen. Good job.
Amen. So, Pastor, we want